I just want to share a couple of quick announcements. Annual Conference 2020 has been canceled for this summer. For more details, please visit brethren.org. Thank you for your continued support and generosity for the church during this time. We ask that you please continue to mail your offerings to the church office. Thank you. As we watch this candle burn, might become for us the light of Christ. The light of Christ that is a lamp for our feet and a light for our paths. May the light of Christ guide you on your walk this day and all days. Join me for our call to worship. You called us to Galilee. You directed us to the mountain. We saw you and we worshiped. We saw you and we doubted. You came to us and began to speak. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. You continued to speak, charging us to go and make disciples of all nations. You commissioned us to baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. You empowered us to teach them to obey all you have taught and commanded us. You asked us to remember you are with us always. Let's take a few moments of silent reflection to consider the joys and concerns we have in our lives. As we enter our time of prayer, I invite you to join me after each petition in saying, Lord, have mercy. Let us pray. Seeking peace in a broken world, but also knowing God's peace through God's presence, we pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. seeking peace and suffering, illness and pain, but also feeling God's peace through healing, prayer, and those who help, we pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Seeking peace through our distress, depression, isolation, and fear, but also feeling God's peace through the words of loved ones and the hope we see in the world, we pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Seeking peace through the pain of worshiping separately, longing for our holy community to be gathering, but also feeling peace through God's presence with each of us as we worship together distantly, we pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, loving Lord. We need you now, as we have needed you every day. We cannot live without you. Amen.
As a community, we take time to pause and give thanks to the gift of mothers. Shining a light on the gift, shadow falls. We acknowledge the shadows too. We celebrate and give thanks, each of us, for our mothers, the women who carried us in our womb, gave birth to us, brought us into life. We lament, each of us, separation from our mothers at different times, through conflict, distance of place, death. We lament, seek to forgive and be forgiven. We celebrate and give thanks, each of us, for those who have been as mothers to us, our aunts and pseudo-aunts, big sisters, friends, mentors, teachers, the women who have nurtured, taught, encouraged, shaped us with love. We lament, each of us, the women who have caused us pain, who have abandoned or neglected us, mistakenly or intentionally caused us harm. We lament the hurt we have caused to women, our friends, colleagues, neighbors, sisters, aunts, and mothers. We lament, seek to forgive and be forgiven. We celebrate and give thanks together for the women in our communities. The women and men are different, invites us into partnership, invites us to share the burdens and the joys of life. For many strengths of women, their gifts of peacemaking, nurture, education, entrepreneurship, healing, wisdom, creativity, endurance, collaboration, physicality, and so much more, we are grateful. We laminate together that women are still discounted because they are women in our culture and in others, that the difference between women and men is seen as threatening. A power struggle, a competition, or a hierarchy is not, we know, your dream for us. We lament, seek to forgive and be forgiven. We celebrate those of us who are mothers and grandmothers, and joy and privilege it is to collaborate with you in the creation of life. We give thanks for our children, their uniqueness, the light we find in watching and helping them grow. We lament those of us who are not mothers and want to be, or who are mothers or children who have died. We lament and have no words for our grief. We celebrate, we give thanks for you, our mothering God, whose wings enfold us like those of a mother hen, who give birth to all that lives, who loves fiercely, protectively, and with great delight. We celebrate what we know of you as like a mother. We lament our turning from you and causing you pain, our rejection of your gifts of life and love in so many ways. We seek your forgiveness again and again. Again and again, God welcomes us home, as a mother welcomes her children. Again and again, God celebrates us, God's children, and delights in watching and helping us grow. Come now, under the wings of God, come now into the warmth of love. You are forgiven. You are loved, precious child of your mothering God.
11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age."
Where I come from, Indianapolis, Indiana, the entire month of May should be declared a national holiday, because May is the month of the greatest spectacle in racing, the Indianapolis 500. Every Memorial Day weekend, well, except for this year because the race has been pushed back to August, but every year, fans from the world all over the world gather to watch 33 drivers in cars that can reach up to speeds of 240 miles an hour race each other for 200 laps on a 2.5 mile long track, totaling 500 miles. And the whole month of May, the entire city of Indianapolis, the whole state of Indiana, celebrates the Indy 500. Hotels all over the city are booked to capacity. Roads in and around Speedway, Indiana are blocked off and closed. Traffic comes to a halt. Restaurants and retail see some of their highest profits near race time. Churches across the city are empty the day of the race. The Indianapolis Motor Speedway is packed full from early morning to late night. And when those famous words, you know the words, "Ladies and gentlemen, start your engines," are uttered and the green flag waves, it's go time. And as I've thought about this text, Matthew 28, 16 through 20, often called the Great Commission, I see Jesus waving that green flag. I hear Jesus uttering similar words, "Disciples and followers, start your mission." I hear Jesus telling his disciples then and us today, it's go time. But like all drivers in every race, whether it's IndyCar, NASCAR, that's for you, Carl, Formula One, etc., they must be equipped with the skills needed to race and empowered to make split-second decisions as they race. We need to be equipped and empowered as well. Race car drivers equip and empower themselves through practice and assembling the best team they can. We are equipped and empowered, firstly, through a relationship with God the Creator, Christ the Redeemer, and the Holy Spirit the Sustainer. Secondly, through active participation in the community of faith. Thirdly, through spiritual practices such as prayer, Lectio Divina, meditation, spending time in nature. And fourthly, through discerning what gifts you have and putting those gifts to use. When we are equipped and empowered, we can go. As we turn towards our text for today, let us strive to understand what Jesus means in this great commission he gives his disciples and followers then and now. I've mentioned in past sermons that sometimes we approach Scripture believing we know what the words and passages mean. We have all sorts of preconceived notions about what this passage means or what that passage means. Matthew 28, 16 through 20 is no different. Why don't we take a few moments to either jot down or discuss with whomever we're with what some of our preconceived notions of Matthew 28, 16 through 20, the Great Commission, are. Today's final Jeopardy is this. This is the interpretation I bring with me to Matthew 28, 16 through 20, the Great Commission. And remember, your answer must be in the form of a question. Simply converting people to Christianity. I thought all I had to do was get people to accept Jesus as their Lord and Savior. Something like this. Do you know Jesus? He loves you so much, he died for your sins. Are you ready to accept him as your Lord and Savior? Yeah? Well, great. All you have to do is say these magic words. I accept Jesus Christ as my personal Lord and Savior. And I don't mean to take those words lightly, but I really believed that's all I had to do. And that was it. My job was done. And if I got a person to become a Christian and I had made a disciple, well, good job me. What a wonderful job I did being a faithful servant. But is that what this text really means? Part of having faith means having the ability to admit we may not have the right answers, and being able to say we don't know or that we're wrong. So as I look at my notion of what the Great Commission means, I have to ask, am I right or am I wrong? Turns out, I was wrong. I didn't have a clue what this text meant or what Jesus was really asking of his disciples and followers, me and us, when he spoke these words. So maybe we can set aside these preconceived notions we have and look at the text with fresh eyes to discover what Jesus really means in the Great Commission. The first thing we notice is that this is a command. It's not a dare. It's not even a double dare. It's not a triple dog dare. It's not a good idea. It's not a recommendation. It's not a suggestion. It's a command. This is the work we need to be doing. This is the work what we have to do. This is the mission we need to accomplish. In my prayer time, I often ask God, God, what am I supposed to be doing? Am I doing what you want, Lord? And as I read the words of the Great Commission, I hear God's response loud and clear. You want to know what to do? Do this. The first part of the command is the word go. What we often think is that this word go is the command. Go is not the command. Go is an expectation that we should be going. As followers of Jesus, we're expected to continually be going somewhere out there, outside our inner circles, our cliques, our congregations, our homes. We are supposed to be getting out of our comfort zones. We're supposed to step out our doors and get on the road. for the church, that means we are expected to continually be going outside these walls, outside this building, out into the world. As I wrote this, I realized the summary of our compelling vision in the Church of the Brethren is Jesus in the neighborhood. I've been asking myself, how do we see Jesus in the neighborhood? But the Great Commission asks us, how are we being Jesus in the neighborhood? For us who follow Jesus, this word go means we're supposed to be actively going into the neighborhoods and communities that surround our church buildings and actively seek to meet their needs, their real, true, deepest needs. Of course, right now we are being asked to stay home, to limit our contact with other people, so physically going isn't possible right now. But God gave us brains and imaginations. And now, perhaps more than ever, we need to use our brains and use our imaginations to think outside the box about how we might go. And you know what? God's also blessed us with highly intelligent scientists, engineers, and programmers that have created the technology to do what we're doing right now, virtual, online, digital worship, to be able to film at home in my dining room, and for you to be able to watch on YouTube in your homes or at your work, wherever you might be. Maybe in today's rapidly changing world, smartphones, social media, computers, and the internet are gifts and blessings from God. Gifts and blessings that equip and empower us to go. The phrase make disciples is a little more complicated. When we hear the word make, we conjure up all sorts of images, action figures, dining room tables, food, televisions, things, stuff, products that we make, all things that have a particular process to follow in their production, all things that have a desired end result. When we attempt to make a disciple, we have this process and this end result in mind, and we follow this process to the T, to the letter, and the result will be a disciple. And we make them into these people, we make people into something they're not yet currently. We might even have a mold we always use to make sure the disciple looks like this and talks like this and acts like this. And eventually, all disciples will look, talk, and act like this. Now, don't you think that would be incredibly boring? What if the process needs to be different for each person? What if people don't fit so easily into molds? What if what worked back then doesn't work anymore? Might we need to consider changing up how we make disciples? How we do church? How we be church? What if our understanding of make doesn't even fit here? What if we're not in control? What if we're not in control of the process or the end result? Next, we get to all nations. All nations could be thought of as all countries. Here's the crazy part in that. The church has made all of these countries its mission field. That's great. But the not so great part is that the mission field often excludes local communities, our neighborhoods. The mission field has become everywhere but where we live. The mission field has become everywhere but the communities and neighborhoods in which our churches are a part. Maybe when we think of all nations, we ought to include the towns and cities in which we live. Which is why I am excited about our compelling vision. And yes, today we received word that annual conference has been canceled this summer. So we won't finish this compelling vision process until summer 2021. But I'm still excited about it all. Jesus in the neighborhood. My hope is that this vision can help us focus on our neighborhoods and communities as our mission field. That it will equip, empower, and embolden us to be Jesus in the neighborhood. Equip, empower, and embolden us to be Jesus in the neighborhood. I'm reminded of something my friend Jeremy Ashworth, pastor at Circle of Peace in Peoria, Arizona, said at annual conference last summer. Enlisting all the people he's met through ministry, people from Australia all the way to Zambia, recognizing they have all come here to the United States, Jeremy shared, Jesus said, go into all the nations and go. We should absolutely go. Go. And American Christians, listen to me. The Holy Spirit is bringing the nations to us. Think about that. People of all nations and backgrounds live right next door to us. So we take these words, go, make disciples, all nations, and with our preconceived notions, we string them together, and what do we get? We get something that says, go to other countries where you're not currently, and make people into something they're not currently. And that's what it means to be a disciple. If you would have asked me in high school, I would have said that is exactly what it means to be a disciple. And that's exactly how we're supposed to make disciples. Nothing more than that, nothing less than that. That's it. Then we have to teach them to obey. Now, many of you are teachers, and this past week was Teacher Appreciation Week. So I want to say thank you to each and every teacher out there. You are facing a big, big challenge right now, and I applaud you for the hard work, creativity, and imagination you are using to reach and maintain that connection with your students. Simply put, teaching is based on content and information. Now, teaching is much more complicated and complex than just passing on information, but for our purposes, this is how we'll look at teaching. We first ask, what do these disciples not know? What do they need to know? What do they need to know to be molded into the perfect disciple? And whatever it is we think they need to know, we teach them and expect them to obey. So we go to other countries and turn people into something they're not currently by teaching them and making them obey what we teach them. This version of discipleship takes the emphasis off me and puts it on getting others to be what we think they should be and do what we think they should do. And this is what we call discipleship. The problem with this notion that the Great Commission means to go to other countries, mold people into a particular form of disciple, and ask them to follow and obey what we teach, is it's not at all close to what Matthew writes. It's not at all close to what Jesus said. Because the word disciples, that phrase, make disciples, we read it as a noun. But in fact, it's not a noun. It's a verb. It's an action verb. In the Greek, it is mathateu. It's an action verb that we do, as followers of Jesus. It means we are the ones discipling. As followers of Jesus, we embrace discipling. As a verb, as a mathateo, disciple means that we are the students, that we are the pupils, that we work to become devoted followers of Jesus and live out his teachings in the broader world. And that's how we make more disciples. Not by conforming them into a mold we've created, but through our actions as followers of Jesus. It's to progressively learn God's word to become a growing and mature follower of Jesus. It's to train and develop in scriptural truths and a Christ-centered lifestyle. It's to learn to follow Christ in belief and practice. We have to grow and mature, train and develop, and follow Christ in word and deed so that through our beliefs and practices, others will see our faith lived out and be inspired to follow Jesus. When others see our actions as devoted followers of Jesus, they hopefully will be inspired to also become followers of Jesus. Then, as we continue growing, we help others grow as well by walking with them on the journey. All nations should not be understood as all countries. Firstly, we have to remember that Matthew wrote his gospel to the Jewish people. And secondly, if we go all the way back to Matthew 1, we can discover why it shouldn't be understood in this way. Because Matthew 1 contains the genealogy of Jesus. And in this genealogy are women. And one of these women is Rahab. Now, Rahab being a woman means she's inferior in that time and culture. And Rahab, she's also a prostitute, which renders her unclean. And Rahab, who's not Jewish, is in the genealogy of Jesus, a non-Jewish female prostitute. How we should understand nations then is as ethnicities. The word for nations in Greek is ethnos, or ethnicities. So it's not all countries, but all ethnicities. One understanding of the Gospel of Matthew is that Matthew was writing to get the Jewish people to understand that Jesus was the Messiah they were looking for. Another understanding, one I subscribe to, is that Matthew was trying to show that Jesus was the Messiah of all people, which is why Rahab is part of Jesus' genealogy. Jesus wasn't the person the Jews thought he was. Jesus isn't the person we think he is. Jesus was and is for every person, every kind, every skin color, every culture, every ethnicity. Jesus was and is for each and every person on this earth, past, present, and future. And that same message Jeremy preached at annual conference last summer, he shared, the body of Christ was global before any of us got here. The kingdom of God is already global, and there's a good chance your backyard is already global too. So look next door, look across the street, look at the house behind you. Jesus is for them just as much as he is for you. Teaching is causing to learn. A disciple is someone who learns. As disciples, we simply cause people to learn. And for many people, the best way to learn is to watch and observe. And as we are going, there are others making observations about us, just like we watch and observe others. Others, they're observing us. They're seeing us. They're watching us. What are they observing? What are they seeing? What are they watching? Does what they see make them want to change the channel? Others should be able to observe, see, and watch us doing all that Jesus has commanded us. All that Jesus commanded who? Us. Me, you, us. They're watching for us to do what Jesus taught us to do. They're watching for us to love our neighbors and our enemies. They're watching for us to give to the poor and needy. They're watching for us to include the excluded. They're watching for us to welcome the stranger. They're watching for us to speak and fight for justice. They're watching for us to seek peace and unity, to live peace and to live unity. They're watching for us to care for the sick and the suffering and the dying. They're watching for us to protect the widows and the orphans and the refugees and the immigrants. They're watching for us to provide shelter for the homeless and safety for the abused. They're watching for us to live the faith we have in Jesus. They're watching for us to embody his teachings and lessons. They're watching. They are watching. They're watching. And what, brothers and sisters, do you think they see? When others see us doing what Jesus has commissioned and commanded us to do, hopefully they'll be interested and intrigued enough to open up the conversation. But if they don't see us doing what we've been tasked to do, what do you think will happen? In the Great Commission, Jesus is saying that as we are going to work, going to school, going to the store, going home, going on a walk in our neighborhood, we should be living our faith, practicing what we believe, embodying his work, his teachings, his mission, his vision, so others will see us doing what Jesus has taught us to do. That, brothers and sisters, is discipleship. Knowing that, can me and you, can all of us, commit to living our lives in public and in private. When we're out there and when we're in here. In ways that the people we encounter, friends, family members, strangers, enemies, neighbors, can we live our lives in such a way that they easily see we follow Jesus? That they see our faith in Jesus, that they see us embodying everything Jesus taught, that they see us living and practicing our faith and beliefs. Only by living as disciples ourselves can we ever hope to make other disciples. We have been commissioned to do so. And if we have been commissioned to do so, rest assured that we will be equipped, that we will be empowered, that we will be enabled to carry out the mission of Jesus, to continue the work of Jesus. And in fact, brothers and sisters, you, each and every one of you watching this, you've already been equipped. You've already been empowered. You've already been enabled. And a couple weeks from now, we will celebrate Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit came down on the 12 disciples. The Holy Spirit has come down on you. The Holy Spirit dwells in you. The Holy Spirit has equipped you, empowered you, enabled you to continue the work of Jesus. Ladies and gentlemen, start your engines. Jesus is waving the green flag. Now go. Amen.
Join me in this commissioning for our benediction. Jesus, we worship you, and sometimes we doubt, yet we know all authority is yours. So you call us to go to all nations, to make disciples, to continue your mission. You call us to announce your kingdom, to heal the sick, to care for the needy, to love neighbor and enemy. You call us to baptize in your name. You are Father, you are Son, you are Holy Spirit. We will follow, we will obey, and teach all you have commanded, for you are with us always, day after day, year after year, to the very end of the age. Amen.
you're still here. Why are you still here? You're supposed to be out there continuing the work of Jesus. Go, get out there, you know, go be Jesus in the neighborhood. You're expecting a preview for next Sunday. Now, we don't have that kind of time. What were you expecting? Some kind of shelter from the storm? Go! Get out there! I can tell you, in the many storms of life we each face, we can find shelter and refuge in the Lord. Now go, get out of here and get out there. Do the work God has given you. Continue the work of Jesus peacefully, simply, together. Amen.